everlasting God, the everlasting God.
All right, welcome to church, everybody. Got my little baby, my princess. She's looking around this week. Last week, first service got a little sneak peek, and then I had to run over to LifeNet, so I didn't want to leave you guys out. Lachelle didn't want to come up here either, so but it's okay. She's doing good. She's here. So, but this is our daughter, Kylie. This is her. She actually sat through Mark, didn't scare her, so that's pretty good for a service. So just been a blessing. Excited to introduce her to you guys. She's like, what's going on now? But just been blessed. So this is our little daughter. God is good. She's incredible. Awesome. So good thing Danielle is going to do some announcements this morning because VBS starts tonight. So excited for that. She's excited for that. She needs some caffeine or tea or something. So just excited. A couple of things, just real fast. Wednesday night for youth group, we will not have typical service upstairs. We're going to be serving for VBS. We're going to be helping. So if your students, your kids want to come and bless the church, bless families, and just work with the kids this Wednesday. It starts at 6, but if they still can only get here at 7, they can jump right in with us. But excited for that and that opportunity. So you don't just say, oh, well, I'm not coming because we're not having it. We're still having it because serving is important. Serving is God calls us to serve and love our neighbor as ourselves. And that's we have a fun opportunity this week on Wednesday night to do that, to bless Danielle, the church, and the kids. So that's Wednesday night. Other than that, there is no worship exercise on Monday nights. If you're typically part of that over at LifeNet, it's not taking place this week. Due to VBS and things like that, I'm sure. That'll pick back up here soon. It does look like there is a widow meal delivery and dinner at Caring Kitchen, July 27th, 4 p.m. through 7 p.m. If you want to help out with that, yeah, you don't want to help, do you? If you want to help, woo, it's okay. They all think it's cute. It's okay. So if you want to help out with that, talk to Trish. Her number's here in the bulletin, so that's an awesome opportunity to serve. So Danielle's going to talk. Oh, there's Lachelle. Lachelle's an awesome mom. But I didn't need the passy. I got her to quiet down because I'm just that good. It's okay. Excited for VBS. Danielle's going to share with that. And she's going to pray for us this morning. Yep.
I'll trade you.
Thank you.
Good morning. Good morning. I would like to officially welcome you to Illumination City. Yay! Tonight, Vacation Bible School starts. Kids can arrive here at, it starts at 6 o'clock, so a little bit before 6 in registration. If you're helping I'm just asking helpers to be here at 5:30. Some teams will be here a little bit sooner, so if you're part of a team, you might want to talk to your leader and see if you're going to be here any earlier if they need help. There has been a little bit of confusion with, I know it's hard to get here at 5:30 and eat dinner, so I'm feeding you. So if you're a helper and or a child coming to Vacation Bible School, we're feeding you. So you don't have to worry about eating tonight or any night this week that we're here. Thursday, you're on your own. If you're also helping and you haven't seen me for your t-shirt, I have those today as well, or you can get them tonight if you're not here, or, well, yeah. So I'm super pumped. I'm very, very excited for tonight. We have 144 kids pre-registered, but we are welcoming kids at the door, so that's going to be exciting. Last year, we topped out around 80, so we're almost double what we were last year, which is incredible. So there'll be 144 kids running around in the sanctuary later today. Woo! Woo and ah, like scary and awesome at the same time. Also, if you guys hear it during second service afterwards, if you could do me a big, big favor, all of these chairs need to be stacked along this back corner wall. If you guys could help me in any way of stacking those chairs for tonight, I would very, very, very much appreciate that. So if you have any questions about Vacation Bible School or anything else, just come and see me. And I just thank you all for coming to church. We'll pray. Dear Lord Jesus, I just thank you for this day. I thank you for this church and all the people that have come today. I ask that you bless everyone here and speak to us, Lord. I ask that you bless the offering and let your will be done with it. Lord, for you know our needs. I just ask in Jesus' name that you be with us. And in his name we pray, amen.
Coming back to the start, where you found me. Coming back to your heart, now I surrender. Coming back.
First, I want to thank you for bringing us all together today, and thank you for letting us have the opportunity to share Jesus with others. Let us come alive on your dance floor, Lord. Let people see Jesus in us each day, no matter where we are, gas station, grocery store, talking to our neighbor. Let everyone see Jesus. We thank you that you always make everything glorious. Even though in our eyes it may look like it's not good, but God, you make everything good.
Thank you.
God, for giving us hope and knowing that you will make everything glorious. And Lord, just pray today that you give peace to everyone here, whatever their circumstances might be. That God, many times you allow us to go through the rain, to go through difficult times, but ultimately in the end, you're going to make everything beautiful, Lord. That we just need to trust in you. Help us to remember not to lean on our understanding, but lean on your understanding, God. Your ways are higher than ours. We don't understand, but when we trust you, you will get us through that situation, Lord. We thank you, God. Thank you for your faithfulness.
Amazes me, the circumstances possibly changed. Do I find
Deserving of all of our praise. And Father God, we're going to learn today more about how important it is to praise you when times are good and praise you times when times are bad, Father. No matter what, we praise you. You are our King and our Lord, and we honor you today. And Father God, just turn your ear towards us and hear our cries and hear our praises. Father God, I am so glad and thankful that everyone is to return from Peru, safe and sound, and we've missed our shepherd. We're glad he's back, Lord, and I pray that you fill him with your spirit, and may his words be your words alone, Father God. Be glorified today. We invite you in. Holy Spirit, be with us today. We glorify you. Bless this time together, Lord. In Jesus' name.
Morning. Get that up there. Standing here in Mexico City. I told Keytown Danielle that Batman, because it's a superhero theme, Batman is usually out of Gotham City, you know, New York City. But I didn't know he was in Mexico City. Anyhow, good to see everybody. Glad you're here. Thanks for coming. You know, actually, I was visiting downstairs here and forgot you guys were even up there. And just kidding. Just kidding. Hey, good morning. Glad you're here. Thanks for coming to church. Yeah? Where have you all been? Where have you been for the last 3 weeks? I'm glad to be back. We got Peru people here that'd like to tell you a little bit about their trip. So I invite them to come as we pray today, but we're glad you came. If you went to Peru with me, you ought to be moving right now. Same thing they did with motor cars. They took too long. Try to get them moving. So there they come. They'll share a little bit of Peru stuff. I'm going to preach a little bit. Is that okay? Glad you came. If you haven't been here before, never been here before, glad you're here today and get a little bit of the pastor back and a little bit of his style in preaching, okay? So here comes a girl that has a... You have trouble with them steps? After where you've been?
Just that hand to help.
Yeah. Father, we thank you for time together today to glorify you. Thank you, Lord, for the folks that went to Peru with us and standing here on the stage, just good friends, Lord, Now, Lord, we brought them back safe, and they've been blessed. I pray, Lord, that you'd be with us this morning in our time together. Glorious, wonderful church here, Lord. I pray that the pastor would get his act together and would preach what the heart of God is this morning. Pray, God, that you'd bless that. So, Lord, be with us from this second, Lord, from this very moment to the end. By your power, by your spirit, Lord, speak to each one of us. Cause us to hear things we need to hear. Cause us to be open for our hearts to change. Lord, we give you praise and thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. Sis, that microphone right there, will you give that to me? Here's this group. How many we got? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Missing Kathy Poland's and 8. And me. So we're just missing one lady that was in the first service, and they're all okay. We're glad to have made a big trip here. I've been to Peru since 1996 and been taking church folks. Many of you folks have went to Peru with me. If you haven't yet, you ought to make a plan to do that before this whole thing's over, okay? Because it's a lot of fun, pretty exciting. I'll let these guys share their experiences. Trying to think, where do we start? Tom, you want to start? Tom, you start. How about that, okay?
I knew this was going to happen.
Yeah, okay. There you go.
Hi, I'm Tom. It's good to see you all today. We just got back from the most fantastic mission trip that I've ever been on. I've been involved in missions in South America for many years, and when I just started coming to this church about a year ago, when I found out that Mark had the ministry down in South America, I was pumped and excited because that's what God has called me to do. I think you're looking here at the greatest team of people that could have ever possibly gone down there. I mean, each one of these guys were absolutely fantastic. Actually, I was kind of the court jester. I drove these guys crazy. I apologize for that, for being nuts. I've learned from that. I would say right now that, first of all, the kids, I don't know what to say, okay? I was hoping I could get a slide up here to show. Oh, they do have some pictures. Great. But the kids are just fantastic, okay? These little kids are the most loving little people that I've ever met in my life. I made friends with a couple little girls. I kind of call them my baby girls now. I will find a way to show you pictures of those sometime. I know what to say. I would say if you've never been on a mission trip, start praying about it. And I'm going to put Mark on the spot. If Mark comes by and says to you, you know, you should think about going on a mission trip, that's probably God speaking to you. Okay? So be listening.
I don't do that very often.
Yeah. But if he does, you better be listening because that could be God. Other than that, I would say that probably sort of my hero here was Deb, because if Deb can do it, you can do it. Okay?
And I'll say, if I can do it, you can do it also. It was my first mission trip. I was scared to death to go from a physical standpoint and just in general because it's the unknown. And I absolutely loved it. There were people, this team helped you the whole way. The people in Peru helped you the whole way. So no matter what your limitations might be, there are people that are going to help you. And you'll forget that you ever, you know, were scared to go. And then seeing Maggie and Trent and what they do out there, they were just kind of a figment of my imagination, you know, the missionaries. But once you see it in real life, it really hits your heart, the work that they're doing, the fact that they're so far away, the support that they need, the prayers they need. I can't wait to go back. That's how much I love the trip. I just can't wait to go back.
You volunteered to be the babysitter, right?
I did.
Well, where do I start? To start on the journey, had it not been for my RSC family, I wouldn't have been able to go. Someone helped me with my passport. Someone helped me with the airfare. And then several people gave money so I would have money for expenses. And that all came from the heart of God. And I thank you for that. I just want you to know that anything that was left, I left with Maggie and Trent to use for the ministry. So if anybody wonders if that money helped, yeah. And it's not even the 28th of the month. They usually say by the 28th of the month they're falling short and they wonder what's going to happen, where the money's going to come from. So my personal experience, well, y'all know I fell. I didn't know you knew that. Just saying, okay? I hit my head, you would have thought it would have done some good up there, but
nope,
I'm not sure
it didn't.
It didn't.
It didn't.
But in that, I was embarrassed and just totally, you know, why did I even bother coming? Because I'm going to be the problem.
It was only the very first time we were out, the very first thing did.
Oh, yeah.
So,
going to dinner,
I mean, why not start it off good, you know?
Going to dinner, no less, you know. And to show the loving heart of the people, the lady at the restaurant, the people at the restaurant brought out bandages and alcohol and just helped take care of what was open and what wasn't nice. And
alcohol for drinking or alcohol
no,
for...
alcohol okay. for the wound on,
okay,
the,
all right.
on the arm. Okay,
trying to keep that clear here. Just trying
one.
To...
Yeah, it was a missions trip.
Yeah, time. Yeah. Just trying to keep it straight.
Yeah. Anyway, I didn't go out the next day. For obvious reasons. I was having trouble walking. I took off my shoes and realized I'd broken two of my toes. But no legs, no arms. Everything else was good. Didn't bring back any extra metal, so I feel like that's a good thing for those of you who understand all that. I stayed home that day and helped Maggie with doing up little packets for bracelets that we would be giving out. And just putting together different things for the children. And even at that, it didn't, you know, I'm like, oh, yeah, this is good. But then I went the next day. And the details on this is it poured down rain. so hard you couldn't see beyond the bow of the boat. And where we were going, the water level was so low, there was nothing but clay and sand showing where we had to dock. We had to wait on it to quit raining. The villagers started bringing down planks and trees and things to put down in the mud so that we could get a foothold to get up through there. I'm thinking, yeah, this is going to be fun. You know, I've got a cane in one hand, a broken foot on the other, and just like, somebody said, you know, we'll be up there a while, but you can go, if you don't think you can do it, you can stay in the boat. And my comment was, God didn't bring me down here to sit in the boat. So I don't care if I fall down, whatever, I'm going up to the village. And I did. But it was only with the help of all of our interpreters, the people from the village, they brought down trees that were about this big around that they had cut with machetes and stuck in the ground so that as we were trying to get up those planks and boards, we had something to hold on to get up through there. And then as I got out, Trent, who I felt bad about this until I realized what God was working with me as well as everybody else, Trent came up and put my arm around his neck, and one of our other interpreters on the other side put my arm around his neck, and they walked me up that muddy bank to show me it wasn't about me. It was about what God was doing in me and everybody else. And there wasn't a time after that that Mark didn't assign somebody to security duty. But it was an amazing trip. The kids, the adults, the old people that we saw, all so loving and open and just willing to give you things they don't have, down to going out in the jungle and picking fruit and bringing it back for you to eat. I just, again, I challenge you like everybody else has. If you think you can't do it, just remember I turned 70 in April. And until this year, I haven't even been able to walk 2 blocks. And I probably wouldn't have done a lot of that down there had I not been for a lot of help. But it's not about what you can do if you go. And I felt bad because I couldn't help with the construction or some of the stuff. But it's about what God's doing with you, in you, and using people who were just oblivious to any kind of mindset that you're giving to me and I'm going to make you pay for it. It's not there. It's if you give to me, they come from miles just to be there so they can hear what you have to say and so that their kids can have clothes. So thank you for all of that.
Wonderful.
I think the thing that I experienced this trip, this was my third time in Peru and probably my most awesome trip. We had a team that saw things that needed to be done and jumped in and did it. We worked together as a team. It was a true team effort. This trip taught me that whatever your limitations are or whatever you think they are, to give those to God and He can make you limitless through it. There's just so many memories and so many things to share. And, if you have an interest, if you have a little burning in your heart, you think, wow, I don't know. The worst part of the trip, you eat a lot of chicken. and you have to take cold showers. But about day 3 into the cold showers, you're going to cold shower, man, it's going to feel pretty good. And take them late. Yeah, you learn little tricks, you know. But I felt responsible somewhat for this lady taking her spill. And I think the lesson in that, I'd asked her to wait, and she thought she could do it herself. Does this sound like Deb Bullman? But, you know, I felt bad, but, incredibly, saw God's miracles perform right there in front of us, because she took an awful knot to the head when she kissed that cement. And within 15 minutes, what would have been like that big, it almost went away. And, you know, we were all praying, laying hands on her, and believing for that to be not a bad thing. But there again, it was just a learning thing for all of us. You know, there are dangers there, but there's no danger larger than our God. You know, he's good. If he brought you to it, he's going to get you through it. Amen.
Okay, so this was my first year ever going on a missions trip. But, I mean, honestly, it was just amazing. And it's, at first, I went into the trip and I was kind of like not sure how I was going to feel about it. I was the first younger one there for that first week. And then she came like the second week. But even after the first week, I just started getting close with everybody. They all feel like family. And if I could say anything, I think it'd be for, like, you teenagers. I would encourage you guys to go on a missions trip, like, now while you guys can. And it really just changes your whole outlook on everything. Like, there was one night we had got back, and we were talking about this one night. But I was, I got on Facebook or something, and I was looking at all the stuff going back on at home. And I was just like, wow, like, it just changes your perspective on even stuff like that. Like, you look and you're like, is that stuff, like, really important? And then the stuff that other people were saying, like, I'm like, wow, they really shouldn't look at life that way. It just changes everything. And the kids there were just awesome, and they love attention. You give them attention for, like, 5 minutes or even 2 minutes, and they'll be all over you for that, the next few days or whatever. But it was just great, and I'm so glad that I got to go with this whole group, and that they're all so loving, and it was just awesome. So
there was a doctor.
Oh, yeah, and I got to
there is a Dr. Scooby. There is a Dr. Scooby.
And I got to give Pastor Mark a little shout out, because he doesn't lie and he keeps his word.
I told her there was a Dr. Scooby and I'd get her into surgery because she's going to be a nursing student. And she said, "Oh, he probably just saying that to get me to go." And they're Dr. Scooby, that all sounds crazy. But she figured out I do have a buddy named Dr. Scooby, and he did take her into surgery, so she was grossed out by all that.
It was a hernia surgery. It was pretty sweet, but...
Yeah?
Yep.
You were right there, weren't you?
Yeah, right up next to him. He was working over here, and I was probably, like, right there.
Yeah? And he was cutting off dead skin and flipping it, right?
Yep, he put it on the guy's feet. I don't know what he was doing, but...
Yeah, yeah. So...
Whatever.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
What happens in Peru stays in Peru.
Yeah.
So you let them do their thing.
Yeah, this was my first trip, too. And, wow, there just aren't words, really. First of all, I'd like to say thank you to everyone who made it a possibility. I've always dreamed and wanted to go on a missions trip. Never thought I'd be able to, let alone for the first time to go with my daughter. She turned 18 down there, so it was just an amazing time. We got to spend time together, and... for 2 whole weeks, we didn't argue one time, and that was amazing. But if you've been there, I mean, you know. And if you haven't, there really just aren't words. Yeah, you should. Wow, humbling, life-changing. I pray that God takes this and just never lets it fade. What we learned, what we experienced, I grew so close to the people down there. The team, wow, we really bonded, became a family down there, and it was amazing. The kids, the missionaries, the pastors, people who'd walk hours through the jungle to go preach, and just the conditions, and they were so just humble and grateful and happy, and there's no words. It was just amazing, and I'm so blessed to have been able to go, and thank you.
Nice.
Yeah, this was my first trip, too. I also got to go with my daughter, and for me, the trip was just an incredible mix of adventure and being able to do God's work. Also, what really impressed me was the fact that we got to see the outreach that this church has in a foreign country. You just can't even believe the number of kids we reached in a short amount of time. And Trent and Maggie, too, are just fantastic at the ministry they're doing down there. All of your support, you have no idea how much a little bit goes so far down there. And I agree with everything everyone else said here, too. This was an incredible opportunity to spend time with Mark, to spend time with people I go to church with. You know, a lot of these folks I'd never had talked to before. And, you know, we just had an incredible time and chance to get to know each other and do God's work. And if anybody even has an inkling of going, I recommend you go. It was just awesome. We're going back, so, yeah.
Good. Wonderful. There's my new friend right there.
Before we even left for the trip, I was hesitant about going because I was kind of nervous about it. But once I got there, it was just great. And I also got to go see the surgery, and they were nice enough not to say anything, but I locked my knees while we were standing and watching, and halfway through I passed out.
You said it, I didn't.
Yeah.
I told her, I'm not going to say a thing.
Yeah. So Alandria was really nice, and she stayed out in the hallway with me. Yeah, it was just great.
Good. Well, thank you for going. Pray we get to do it again sometime, okay? All right, thanks much. How about that for a report? Be careful. What's that?
I just had one thing to add.
Go ahead. Is it green?
Yeah.
That crate, go ahead. They got you.
I just had one quick thing to add. Henry, you need to come up.
Henry needs to come up. So people know who Henry is? Is that what you're trying to do?
So people know who Henry is.
Henry's
they don't
here
know
today.
Him. Because Henry is from Peru, and he's been living with Pastor Mark for a couple years.
Yeah.
Anyway, his mom and dad, very influential with our trip, helps as interpreters, and his brother, Junior.
Hey, I have no idea what she's doing. Okay, all right.
And he has a sister down there, Becky. So how long has it been since you've seen them? 8 or 9 years. Can you imagine having a son and not seeing him for 8 or 9 years? How many moms? So his mama, through his dad interpreting, said, I'm to give you a hug and a kiss. Aww. And his sister didn't want to be missed out, so she said, give him a hug and kiss for me, too. There.
Okay. There you go. I didn't see that coming. Yeah, don't knock over Mexico City. Oh, boy, that microphone will frustrate me. My finger won't fit in the little slot. You know what I'm saying? There, it's off. Good. All right. Well, glad you came to church today. If you're a first-time visitor here, we're usually weirder than this. But, hey, all the decoration and the efforts has went into Vacation Bible School and even the youth camp last month. The church is just rolling, man. So we hope that you can bring your kids out and participate, and we're real excited about what's coming. 150, 60 kids will probably be here tonight. I'm going on vacation, that's all I gotta say. No, anyhow, but we're glad that for all that and Danielle's efforts and happy, very happy, okay? So, with all that, can I preach a minute? Would that be okay if I preach a minute? Let's look at Psalms 117 today. Would that be all right? Just got a minute with you. It feels like you have all that stuff, and then it's really hard to preach after somebody's already, you know, really spoken to you already. But Psalms 117. Praise the Lord, all you Gentiles. Loud or laud him. Never use that word, do we? All you people. See that verse? Now, I'm going to tell you what's really interesting about this. You probably don't know this. But here we are in the middle of the Old Testament. Okay? Dead. In fact, I'll tell you how dead in the middle this is. This is the 595th chapter in the Bible. It's the exact middle chapter in the Scripture. If you're counting chapters, this is the middle one in the scripture. Now, in time frame here, probably David is writing this, but the truth is we're dead in the middle of the Old Testament. You know what I'm saying? We're dead in the middle of these kings and the Jewish law and the tradition and all the stuff that they have there. And all of a sudden, the writing that ends up in the very middle of your Bible, the Bible, you know, that was being written over all those years, all these years later, in the 6,000th year here, you know, of God's creation, we figure out that what God does in His Bible is in the very middle of the book, He speaks to us Gentiles and says, hey, you better praise the Lord, you Gentiles. That's pretty weird if you ask me. Because this chapter got stuck in here in the middle of the Old Testament, in the middle of the thing. The Gentiles weren't part of the plan, weren't foreseen, the whole thing, you know what I mean? But God, in His amazing way, said, hey, I'm just going to remind everybody that right in the middle of this thing, hey, there's something I did with my son. I sent him right in the middle of the whole thing to really change everything. But I want to remind those Gentiles, especially at the very end of this story, that they better praise me. And I'm going to put it right in the middle of my book so they know right in the middle of the whole story, right in the middle of the whole thing, that the best thing they can do, the one thing that I require of them, the one thing that they ought to really learn is very important for them, is they better start praising me. You crazy Gentiles, by the way, that's all of you if you didn't know that. That in the middle of the Old Testament book, in the middle of the Psalm, in the middle of this thing, in the middle, what the Lord's speaking to us says, you Gentiles better praise me. And that word, how do you say it? Laud him? You know what that means? Loud in public. That's what that means. That means let it loose. So, just a new commitment today I want to make to you that, hey, we ought to be praisers of God and it ought to be loud and we ought to let it rip. You know what I mean? If you're a believer here today and you realize what the Lord Jesus has done for you and God's plan for you and that He knows the number of hairs on your head and that He cares for your thoughts and your eyes, the desires of your hearts are important to Him and all the stuff that He knows and has planned for you, then you ought to figure out how to make a praise to that guy and you ought to, that God, you know, and you ought to figure out how to do it loud and powerful, you know? I pray that our corporate worship here on Sunday mornings and Wednesday nights, we just kind of figure it out and make a joyful noise, and we just turn it up a whole level, and we say, hey, well, us crazy Gentiles ought to figure out how to praise God, because we're starting to figure out who He is. Right? So I'm here talking to you about, I'm excited in every area of my life. I'm just telling you. I got a knee right here that hurts today, a back that hurts. You know what I mean? We've done all kinds of mission stuff. My bank account's hurting. All the stuff and all the things and all the trouble and all the, you know what I mean? But I'm telling you, what I've learned about praise is the more I praise, the littler all my problems become. The bigger God gets in my life, the more I realize that He really does have it, that He really is in charge, that He really is the author and the finisher of my faith. He really is the creator of everything. He really does a plan, and He is before me. He really is behind me. He'll never leave me nor forsake me. He knows my ways. He knows my heart. He knows my thoughts. You know? And the only thing He requires of me is just praise me. Hey, you crazy Gentiles, praise me loud and proud. You crazy Gentiles, just turn it loose. Just let go and let it rip. You catching that in that verse? And by the way, in all that big old Testament story, I'm just going to make a mention to you Gentiles who come along later. The best thing you can do to me, because I'm going to make a plan for you that you might be able to know me. The one thing I require of you is you praise me. I just talk to you personally. If you don't make time in your life to really praise God, you ought to make that time. If you don't have alone time with God every day, you really ought to make that time. This is what happens in life. Life circumstances come and they overwhelm you. I'm telling you, all of you, if you don't have a big God component in your life, something even right now in your life is overtaking you. You hear me? Every one of us. There's something that has blown up in our life that is so powerful and so big. It's got us all distracted. It's got us all messed up. So every one of us, the one thing we have in common is the enemy is going to come along, hey, and try to mess us up with what's happening around our life. Right? That's what happens. Listen, many of us are looking for a crisis all the time. It's almost like we go from one to the next, you know, and we get this one done and we're afraid to look around the corner because we're afraid of the next thing that's coming, you know. afraid to go to the mailbox because the next bill is in the mailbox, you know, afraid of the next phone call, worried about what that is. Look at a phone call, see, oh, I'm scared of that. Afraid of family, afraid of this thing, or afraid of that. Get angry about that. All this, woo, 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 all the stuff that happens in life. But it's what the enemy does to always continually keep us wrapped up in us. And when those things are our problems are big and God's small. But when we start having time to praise God and recognize who He is and how big He is and how great He is, and when you really begin to talk to God about, Lord, You are amazing and wonderful and big, life stuff seems to get kind of small. On these Peru trips and these things that we do, I try to communicate over and over about everything you need on your journey. That's what I try to do. We get up in the morning, I had a bunch of, I think 8 or so of the 10 that went were brand new people in Peru. I've been there many times. I know what they're thinking. I already know what they're thinking. I got to put you on a motor car, which is a motorcycle with a little bench seat in the back of it. I got to send you down roads you don't know where, and you don't know where you're going, and you don't know how much money you got. The whole thing crazy. And I try to tell you, listen, you can't control it anyhow. In America, you think you got some control of your life. Really, you don't have control of that either. But you've been able to try to figure it out enough. In fact, for some of you, I can say that whole control thing that you're trying to do is really keeping you from walking where God wants you to walk. I always like to tell this Abraham story. I'm going to come back to that Peru thing, just hold right there for a second. But that whole Abraham story is, the Lord said to Abraham, Abraham, get away from your wife and family. Not your wife. Your family. Keep your wife. Don't get away from your wife. Get away from your family and all those things you know and go to a land that I'm showing you. That's what He says, right? To Abraham. Because He knows if Abraham stays in that same land, Abraham will end up being just like his father. You hear me? You let a man stay where his father is, he'll end up turning into his father. You get that? One reason why I believe, I know this sounds crazy to everybody, my dad died pretty young, but I believe that God had a desire for me that was very different than my father. Does that make sense? That what I would do with my life was going to be very different than what my father. My father was a builder. I grew up building. Does that make sense? And if my father would have lived, we would have kept building together. My father and I would have been builders. Does that make sense? That's what we would have done. That's what we do. But my dad died at some point along the way, and I have wrestled that. There's people here wrestling that now. And in the moment, it just crushed me. It killed me. It was a mess. But the truth of the matter, as I reflect on that now, was God had something for me beyond what was in my father's house. And Abraham was required to leave his father's house and go to a land that God would show him. And the Bible says at some point on that journey of leaving, he passes this tree. I know that sounds very... But it's a... Some kind of tree is listed. And the reason why it's listed there is because that's the farthest point that Abraham had ever known. Everybody hear that? So at some point, the Bible recognized that now Abraham has gone beyond any point that he's ever known. Often in a mission trip, you go beyond any point you've ever known. And as soon as he passes that point and gets into this land, the Lord says to him, "Now, Abraham, now I can use you the way I want to use you, and every place you put your foot, I'll give you that land, and I'll bless you when you're coming and you're going, and I'll make you, your descendants will be great as the sands of the sea, and I'll bless every nation that blesses you." Now, I was back on that Peru trip somewhere, I'm putting you on a motor car. And I, you know, just had trouble, get on a motor car and go. Well, we don't know what's ahead, we don't have money, we don't have this, blah, blah, blah. Just get on a motor car and go. It's on your journey, it's on your journey, it's on your journey. I'm trying to tell you, everything you need is on God's path for your life. Don't stand back and try to figure the whole thing out. Go! There's a lady that I've been running into about every morning. She always asks me, "Do you want this to stay or to go?" And I always go, "Go, go, go." And so I walk in there to this counter, you know, and she says, "There's go, go, go." That's what she says to me. I said, "Yeah, you got me figured out. Let's go." For me, a long time ago, I had a pretty, very secure engineering job, was doing pretty good in life. I was a fourth employee of the company. I knew every product, every price, every customer, everything. But the Lord is speaking me to step out on a... Dumbest thing I ever did to find the greatest thing I've ever found. Amen. You know what I mean? A journey just trusting God through life, living life in God's terms, not worried about every little thing. thing that comes along, not getting all caught up, trying to get caught up in all the devil's distractions and all the things you throw, trying not to live a life where every problem just eats me alive. Does that make sense? And I go from problem to problem to problem, trying to live in this thing where listen, I'm going to praise God, and God's going to be big, and this stuff's going to be small. You hear me? For you Christians, you got God on your side. I'm going to show you that in just a minute. Verses, amazing verses. You got God. You start every day with the Lord. He'll never leave you nor forsake you. He's there. He's present. You choose what you make big. For me and my house, I'll choose to make God big and my problems small. I'll choose to believe God bigger than everything I'll ever face. Everything I'll ever face in my life. I someday will face death if the Lord doesn't come get me. And I'm telling you something. My God is bigger than my death. That makes sense? I will not fear, right? The Lord didn't give me a spirit of fear. He gave me power, love, and a sound mind. God trying to do something amazing in me. But I either want to control it or men are bad about getting in this routine. On a mission trip, God often blows that whole thing away. I tell people on a mission field, I say, listen, chances are you're going to go back and become the person you were before you came. Unless you make a decision that you're never going to be the same again. So praise the Lord, all you Gentiles. Praise Him loud. Let it rip. All you people. Next one. Now I'm going to do good here. Because this chapter only has two verses. So I'm going to preach a whole chapter here really quick. Doing good. For His merciful kindness is great towards us. Now, who's He talking about in this chapter? The Gentiles. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. You just praise the Lord, and you're going to find His merciful kindness is great towards you. I was a 20-year-old man looking for me a haughty wife, praying to God, saying, God, give me the best you have. Lord, I know I'm a loser. Give me a good one. And the Lord gives me the best woman on planet Earth. Pray for Him to give me a job that, hey, I could support my family with. And it was important to me that I could really bless my church. The Lord gave me a good job, and I think, well, bless the church. You know what I mean? What's funny is the more I tried to bless, the more God seemed to pour it on me. Does that make sense? His merciful kindness towards me has been amazing. Yeah, I'm that crazy Gentile that, listen, I know I've got it wrong most of the days of my life, but there's days when I say, God, You're amazing. Lord, I love You. Your plan and Your ability and Your greatness, Lord, is beyond my ability to understand. Thank You for being for me. And He comes back again and says, you know, His merciful kindness is great towards me. Yeah, it is. See, I get up every day thinking, hey, the Lord's on my side. In fact, you're going to see that here in just a second, real obvious. In fact, Colin, it's the next verse, isn't it? Just so I can keep stop doing this. The next verse, Psalms 18:6, the next verse I go to, the Lord is on my side. You see that? I get up every morning saying, Lord, You're on my side. I start every day with, hey, the Lord's on my side. You get that? I hope you do. I hope you don't get up going, oh, I hate my job. I hate this life. I hate the dog. I hate my car. I hate... You never more say, hey, the Lord's on my side. See, it's right there. I didn't make it up. And His merciful kindness, what? Is towards me. I get up every day saying, hey, the Lord wants to be good to me. He's on my side. I try to remind my wife over the years, and she gets mad at me for things, and she starts to rip into me about things. I start to say to her, honey, we're on the same team. I'm on your side. Often that doesn't help a whole lot, but I try. I try. We're on the same team. I'm with you. I'm for you. Especially if you disagree in opinion a little bit, you know. All of a sudden, sometimes people think, you know, that's kind of crazy. Sometimes people think that you're not with them if you just disagree with them a little bit. And the truth of the matter is, listen, all of us Christians, we may disagree a little bit on a whole bunch of little things, but we're on the same side. This whole thing, by the way, I just ready to throw a gauntlet down on it. This whole thing where people get mad at each other in church and don't come back to church anymore, that's so stupid. I'm so tired of that. I'm so tired of the devil getting in. It just gets me so mad. I'm just publicly starting to say it. Most of our trouble here in church is people get mad at each other over little stupid things. Something somebody says. Na, 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 na. You know what I mean? Oh, I'm so mad I'm not going back. Stop. Quit it. Can you grow up past 2 years old? Really? I mean, what is it? Maybe it's teenage. I'll give you 11 years old. Can you get past that? Really? And start serving God. Quit letting the little speed bumps blow your tires off. Really? This whole thing's about over. You guys understand that? This whole thing's about over. God in heaven's giant and big. You ought to be worshiping Him. You ought to be in church learning everything you can learn. You ought to be so committed to your brothers and sisters and trying to work together as a team and seeing the amazing thing that God can do with us together. You know what I mean? Along with your brother that's different than you, that has a different gift, and at some point you'll learn to appreciate because that different gift is really going to minister to you at some point. Does that make sense? You get all that whole thing? I'm just telling you how amazing the church is, how amazing God's plan is. And when God is in the middle of it, it's glorious. By the way, He makes everything glorious. I think we sang that. Even the broken stuff. I tell you, Dane and Sherry, I think they're gone. Good, I can tell a story. Sherry's still there. Darn. But Sherry knows this. Dana's someplace, isn't he? First conversation I had with Dana Horsley wasn't a good one. They came to our church, liked our church pretty well. Said, hey, we play live music. We could play, where'd you play live music at? Well, me and my father-in-law, we played in a bar a lot. Red flag goes up for me. We played in a Methodist church some. That's another red flag for me. I don't know which is worse, the bar or the Methodist church. That's a joke, it's a joke. If you're Methodist, I love you, okay? I'm kidding. Kidding, I'm kidding. Just joking. Sometimes, come on, give me a break. Anyhow, somebody comes on strong and says they want to play live music. They haven't been to church very long. I look at them like, no, we're doing fine. We were playing karaoke music. We were playing pre-recorded music and singing to that. And he's saying that. He said to me, that's stupid. When you got people who play music in your church, why would you play karaoke music? And I just thought, with your attitude right there, I'm be very happy to have karaoke music. I really don't need a guy that's going to yell at the pastor the first time we have a conversation. So he thinks he's trying to offer to me something good. That conversation all went bad. I'm just telling you, for me it was like, whoa. Slow down, mister. Guess what? Dana has not only done a beautiful job playing music for us for years and years and years, he's become one of my very best friends. And if that brother would have left me, I'd experience terrible loss. So this whole thing where you disagree on something, but that's enough to split you up, that's the dumbest thing. Because that person is trying to probably make you better. Does that make sense? Back to this. The Lord's on my side. I will not fear. By the way, fear or being afraid is mentioned 365 times in the Scripture. So if you go look it up, you'd have a do not fear verse for every single day of the year. So you ought to be getting up saying, the Lord's on my side, and the one thing I know today is I'm not supposed to be afraid. What you heard today standing on this stage was people that had an inherent fear about what they couldn't do. They'd let the enemy for years say, you can't do that. Deb didn't tell you that often on this, the water was way down, and when the water's way down, the rivers don't come high up into these villages. The variation in water really makes a difference in terms of how far you have to walk to these villages. Because lots of times these boats can get very close to the village if the water's high. I mean, it varies, well, the height of this room here in height, and that height allows a boat to go way closer to a village. The water's down, so guess what? I'm with a whole bunch of old people, and I'm joking. But and the water's down. That means we got to walk a long way. But you know what happens is they have all these little natural little waterways that come out of the jungle into these rivers. So you walk up these long jungle walks. You walk up these little waterways that are 6 feet deep, and you got a lady with a crutch, or not a crutch, but a cane. And women that aren't used to walking on logs every day of their life to get across it. And you walk up that, and you can just look at their face going, you didn't tell me the boat's bad enough. You didn't tell me I'm going to have to walk across this log. Hey, it's just part of the journey. Aren't you glad I didn't tell you? Because if I'd have told you, you'd have been twice as scared. You wouldn't have slept at all last night. You what? If you'd have told us, you'd have killed me down there, right? Guess what happens? About our journey. The Lord's on my side. And I just sense every step, Lord's on my side. I don't know what the heck I'm doing out here, God. I wouldn't be out here if you didn't call me out here. But you're on my side. And with help from others and just a great big God looking down on us. It's so funny how the first time Deb and some of the ladies went across those logs, they were scared to death. Then we did that 3 or 4 days in a row. You know what? By the third or fourth day, they're walking across those logs. I didn't know, big deal. And every time, this ain't nothing. Give me a smaller log and a bigger ditch. You know what I mean? That's pretty much what their attitude was. They got the place, I was so scared to get in and out of boats. You know what? Getting out of a boat, they'd say to me, getting out of a boat ain't nothing. I figured out how to do that at nothing. The Lord's on my side. I will not fear what man can do to me. What can man or what man can do to me? Same thought there. Again, if you get this attitude, and often it comes from a praise. The one man we were listening to on television the other night says, hey, praise is the beginning of everything, because when you start to praise, what gets deposited in you when you praise is peace. So when you praise, you get back peace, and peace is the beginning of every good thing that God begins to work in you. Because once you got a peace running in you, all of a sudden you can begin to, hey, tackle these giants, because there's a peace that runs through you. You get a lot of courage, and you get real brave, and you start to walk through things you couldn't, because a praise brings a peace, and a peace lets you begin to deal with things you never wanted to deal with before. Sometimes we worry about men, people. This verse right here says, the Lord's on my side, I will not fear what a man, what can man do to me? Meaning, there ain't nobody gonna mess with you beyond him. You get that? Next verse. The Lord is for me. The Lord is for me among those who help me. I love that verse because as I stepped out to do what I do now, I've always had this thing. Listen, maybe I'm weird, but from a little boy, my mama put something in my heart that said, God loves me. And because God loves me, I figured he'd love me, well, and me just being me, and the good and the bad and the... I know how I love my kids, and I love them in the good and the bad and the whole thing. They may not think I do, because there's times when I'm pretty harsh with them, but even in that, I'm loving them. I'm trying to get them to understand we're going to get better. But from a little boy, I began to realize God loves me. He's for me. He is for me. He is for me. He's on my side. This verse, this chapter is really great for you to kind of get. I'm trying to pour something in you today that you got to get. It needs to be the foundational thing for dealing with life in this crazy world we live in. The very first thing you need to remember every day is the Lord is for you. He's on your side. Nothing is going to overwhelm you or overtake you unless you allow it. And he's with or among those who help me. And I've learned over the years, I stepped out to do something for the Lord. All those that would come along and help me, you know what I mean? The Lord would bless them too. He'd be for them too. Therefore, I shall see my desire on those who hate me. Now, just try to help with this. In that day, when they're writing these Psalms, you could actually pray that the Lord would kill your enemies. Or break off their teeth in their mouth. There's one place where David says, Lord, would you just go to my enemies and break their teeth off in their mouth? But Jesus came along and this is what he said. He said, this new commandment I give to you. And at that moment, everything they were allowed to do in the Old Testament, you don't do. He said, love your enemies. Pray for those who despise. So we'd love to say, hey, let's pray that God kills our enemies or gets our enemies. But Jesus comes along and he changes that. In that day, they said, yeah, I pray that my desires hit my enemies, you know, whatever I desire to get them, you know. Next one. It's better to trust in the Lord than put my confidence in man. Sometimes you don't get my humor. I don't mean it. There's a fella, because we do this drug, helping these guys out of prison and some of this stuff, there's a fella for years been coming along saying, hey, I'm going to help you financially. Okay. But he's slower than the U.S. government. You know what I mean? And he keeps saying, I'm going to help you. But every time I meet with him, and, you know, we start some of this saying, hey, you know, we can't do all this on our own and we need some help and the whole thing. And these men have come along and they promised to help and they just haven't. There's always an excuse or there's always a thing and there's always. But you fall back on, but God called me to something. I don't know why I ever got my confidence in a man helping me anyhow. That makes sense? And often that's what we do in life. We see a person as, the one thing I really want to not do in Peru is cause those people that are in Peru to think that we're their suppliers. I assure to you that the money that the church helps with buys lumber and builds buildings and you know, and is involved in, it's not helping individuals. Do you understand that? If people that go want to help individuals, they can. But the truth of the matter is the church never gives money to help individuals. It's always, you over the years have given some money to go to South America, and that's put in buildings that still remain and are having churches even right now as we speak. There are church buildings your money has built, and I'm telling you, there's a reward from that. You can't even measure, can't even understand. Someday you're going to get this, hey, a new car. What's that, Lord? Well, that's because you gave money and it blessed many in places you didn't see. I'm kidding. You don't need to get a car. You're going to be like the Jetsons in heaven. You're going to be, never mind. Put your confidence in man. Don't do it. Put your confidence in the Lord. Right? Today, if you trust in a man, I'm telling you, the Lord would love you to move that confidence off a man and onto him. You hear me? All you wives, every wife in here goes, yeah, I thought he was going to be Prince Charming. When I met him, I thought he had a white horse and maybe he had a white Corvette or something, you know what I mean? Then I married him. I've been trying to straighten him out all these years. In our closest relationships, hey, put your confidence in God. Don't have an expectation that a man can fulfill everything, hey, that you need. You hear me? A man, there's no way a man can do everything that you need done. man or woman here. You hear me? But God is the knower, the one who knows the intentions of your heart. He's the one that knows your desires. He's the one that knows what you need. If you put your confidence in the Lord and walk that journey and not stand still or be afraid and walk a journey that God has before you, on that path, everything that you need will unfold. When you get to that place, listen, I really need to try to get this across to you. When you let go and get to the place where God's calling you, it's in that place God will bless you. And often for many of you, you say, well, I don't feel like God is doing like the Bible teaches and all that. It's typically because you're trying to control the situation still. Or you put your confidence in something that isn't ever going to make you happy. At some point, listen, you got to let life be life and put your confidence in God. I try to say this to you all the time. I hope I help you in this. I don't want to repeat myself, but I think people need it so bad. God is good. He's always good. He's good, 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 good. He's on my side. He's the greatest power, the greatest influence, the greatest everything belongs to God, right? People are in a whole different category. You get that? People are people. And I always say it this way, and I hope I don't offend. Most people are average, because that's what average is. That's funny. I don't care what you say. Because most people are average. That makes sense, because that's what average is. There's some people that are above average. There's some people below average. Some are bottom dwellers. I always add that because we know who they are. Anyhow, when you get people stuff mixed up with God stuff, you get really confused, because people stuff gets really crazy. God is good, good, good. And when it's in God, it's beautiful and glorious. And God's working and He's putting discipline in, and it's getting better and getting better. And you're headed towards something good. When people get in, it gets, woo. Starts being divided. It starts being this. We start hearing that. We start doing, whoa, 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 whoa. And sometimes we take the God, the people stuff, and mix it with the God stuff, and we start blaming God for stuff that... it's people's stuff. You got to keep those things separate. As a pastor of the church, I can tell you today, God is so good. God will keep every promise He ever made to you. People are all pretty average. Some will have a heart for you. Listen to me. And those that God puts a heart in them for you, you got to thank God for them. Because that was not them. God, if somebody's been good to you in the last couple of weeks, God has moved them to be good to you. And when people are good, godly good to you, it's because God has sent a person to minister to you. And you ought to be very thankful for that person, and you ought to be very thankful for God. You know what I mean? But the enemy often uses people to cause trouble. He doesn't use God. He can't use God, by the way. He's not God's boss. But God's good. He's good. What did we say before? His merciful kindness is towards me. God looks at me with mercy and kindness. He's on my side, right? Here it's saying, you better put your trust in man, in this, or in God in this category, and not in man in this category. Because this category can get kind of strange. Right? Am I right or not? And often, when we're too wrapped up in this thing, we get confused in everything. Yeah? That's where Facebook has really caused a lot of confusion and hurt feelings. Because we get wrapped up in so much in the people stuff, we forget that God is incredible. Hurry, hurry. Colin, let's just jump to the end, okay? Look at this. Colossians chapter 1. We were there. We got to the 12th verse on Wednesday night. These verses were there. I'm just going to throw them in today. He has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed us in the kingdom of His Son, of His love. If you're a believer today, you talk about a praise. You ought to be so happy God jerked you out of that darkness and put you in the light. You hear me? I was lost and undone. what's the song say? In the miry clay, I was caught up in all that. I could ought to bring all those adjectives, you know, that you could bring. I was carnal as carnal comes. I was stuck in a rut and couldn't get out. I was lost and couldn't be found. But He, praise God, had delivered me from the power of darkness and conveyed me in the kingdom of His Son. Yeah! You know, you're supposed to be praising God loud, let it rip, you know what I mean? So, He has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed us to the kingdom of His Son. Yeah. Aww. Man, Macaulay Center could have done better than that. He has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed us to the kingdom of His Son. That's what I'm talking about right there. That's what I'm talking about. Yeah, somebody finally figured out that we got jerked out darn in the kingdom. Woo! Couple of verses, I gotta be done. Next one here. In whom we have redemption. I don't know if you understand that word redemption well enough. That whole means somebody bought you back. You were gone. You were out of the store. You know what I mean? You were lost and undone. But somebody reached down and redeemed. He brought you back through His blood and forgiveness of sin. Next verse. Colin, just skip it along for you. It pleased the Father that in Him, Jesus, all the fullness should dwell. Go. Last one. And by Him to reconcile all things unto Himself. I get pretty excited to start reading these verses, man. I'm just telling you. That the Lord said, hey, everything that's in Him is going to be all back together. It's going to all be good. In the end, it's all broken things. It's going to be all redeemed again. It's going to be all reconciled. It's going to be all what it should have been. Yeah. Whether on earth or things in heaven, having made peace through the blood of His cross. Yes. Yes. Trying to give you something there to just hit you about a praise there at the end. He jerked me out of darkness, put me in light. He jerked me out of darkness and put me in the kingdom of His Son. And He reconciles all that stuff. He redeemed me out of that whole thing. And listen, and He brings us all together in a grand, glorious place someday where none of it's broken anymore. Yeah! Right? The Lord is for you. What He requires of you Gentiles is get your praise on. You hear me? What can you do for the Lord in any way when honor Him for what He's done for you? Praise. And praise will deposit peace, and peace is the beginning of many good things. Lord, we thank You for time today. Tried to preach my heart out this morning. Pray, God, I deposited stuff in people today they really needed. God, You get big and let the world get little. Comes through praise. Teach us how to praise You, Lord. Teach us how to start every day calling You big and our problems little. Lord, help our church, Lord, we pray. Bless our vacation Bible schools. This starts tonight, Lord. Cause our building to stand, I pray. Through it all, bless those kids, Lord. Pour into those kids. Your word, Your goodness, Your love. God, we give You praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks for coming, everybody. Come get to see us again real soon. Hope to see you again. Very, 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 very soon. Yes. If you'll help with it.